Every Nigerian must be instrumental to the growth and development of our nation through the use of innovative energy and idea to lead and initiate policies that will sustain the economy and enhance good governance. With all the financial turmoil facing the world, it has become pertinent for exchange of new ideas that will enhance good governance. Please subscribe to our channels, listen to our messages and engage with us. With your support, we can transform the lives of all Nigerians. Welcome to the Season 2 of the NESG Radio.
Welcome to the If Not Now When podcast series. So I've written down all of your different roles so that I'll remember, because it's quite a lot. So you've had a long career with the UN, and then you were the former deputy governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria, and then you were a professor at the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy at Tufts in the US, Massachusetts, I believe. And you were also a presidential candidate in 2019.
Yes.
And also for this cycle, but you didn't win the nomination of your party.
Yes.
So actually, that last chapter of your career is what I want to focus on today, right? And let's just start with the idea. So you are a political outsider. Yes, you had an appointed role, but you were never a politician.
Absolutely.
And you tried as an outsider to break into what I call Nigeria's quite unique elite-dominated brand of politics, and didn't succeed, or haven't succeeded yet into breaking it. Let's just start with a broad question. What have you learned from that process?
Well, thank you. First of all, I'll question your judgment that I have not succeeded in breaking in.
Okay.
I think I have, actually. Mm-hmm. Because if you look at Nigeria's politics today, as we prepare for the elections in 2023, there are two things that will dominate the elections. One is the battle between the future and the past. And the battle for the future, I was one of the generals that began that battle in 2019 as a political outsider. And if you look today, the candidate that represents what many people consider the political outside, you know, is drawing on the foundation that people like me laid. So that's success. Success in politics is many things. It's not always about winning the ultimate prize of, say, the election itself. But if you create a wave that changes the future dynamics of Nigeria's politics, as people like me have, then that's a major success. So the fact that today the major issue is that battle between the youth, you know, and their aspirations for their future, and the old guard, we are therefore now inside. So I would not agree with it.
You say we're not inside.
Yes, that is breaking in.
I wasn't able to break in.
No, I say I disagree.
You're not,
we have broken in. You see what I'm saying?
So you're saying that you've helped to reframe the issue as one of
the past and the
looking
future.
Forward.
Yes, and also intergenerational between the youth and the old guard.
Right.
So to the extent that the youth is likely to play a central role, whether they win or not, in terms of the actual prize, it's a different matter. But nobody can debate today that the youth movement will scramble the elections of 2023.
Okay.
That means that thing you called outside is now inside.
It's now inside. Okay, that's fair.
Yes.
Okay. But in the just pure practical power game of actually winning the election.
Sure. Yeah.
Is there anything you would do differently?
Oh, yes.
Knowing what you know today?
Certainly. If I had run in 2023, and by the way, I made a deliberate decision not to run, to withdraw from partisan politics in the 2023 cycle, because even when I was cheated out of the ticket in the political party I was a member of, other parties were offering me their presidential tickets, and I could have taken any one of them if I wanted. So the fact that I lost the primary, lost quote unquote, because we know that what happened was just a game and a conspiracy, not a real electoral loss. But, you know, if I had wanted to go forward, mm-hmm. I could have accepted to go with any of the other mm-hmm. smaller parties that offered me their ticket, but I chose not to. I chose not to for various reasons. Mm-hmm. So, and now I am a non-partisan player in the 2023 presidential cycle. I am not a member of any party, mm-hmm. and I have not officially endorsed any candidate.
So two questions from that. One is, okay, so you said you chose not to.
Yes.
I want to ask why you chose not to.
One
but first I want to ask again, what do you feel like you've learned, or what would you do differently?
What would I do differently?
Yeah.
We'll come back to that question.
Okay.
But let me answer the question of why I chose not to go forward. Now, when these things were playing out in June, mm-hmm. early mid-June, I could also see that what you might call the third force, which many people had hoped that I would represent. Mm-hmm. But when what happened in the African Democratic Congress happened, at that time, another candidate began to come up and became a rallying point for the third force. I chose, for strategic reasons, not to interfere in that development. Because if I had come out on the candidacy of another party, it would have divided the vote of the third force.
Okay.
So I decided to look beyond myself. For me, this is not an ambition, it's an aspiration, you know, for Nigeria. And so that's the reason I made that decision. It was just, I made it in the larger interest of the political evolution mm-hmm. of the country. And to make the point that I wasn't desperate to be president, actually. And there are many ways through which one can contribute. I know I will always be relevant in this country. So for me, it's not about whether I'm president or not. You see what I'm saying?
Understood.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's the reason I made that decision. Mm-hmm. Now back to what would I do differently? Mm-hmm. If I had been a candidate, I would have gone about it in a very structural way. And that's what I learned in 2019.
If you had been a candidate.
If I had been a candidate of a party.
But what about even getting the candidates
I'll come to that. But this is a very important lesson. And that is that popularity is not enough mm-hmm. to win an election in Nigeria, especially mm-hmm. a presidential election.
Right.
You can be popular, as I undoubtedly was when I came out in 2019. But I did not have the structures and the financial capacity to protect my votes. And so I know that my votes were massively stolen across the country. So the result of 22,000 votes, it was laughable. It was not. Well, I didn't defeat Buhari. Mm-hmm. I did not defeat Atiku. But I did not have 22,000 votes. If you believe that, you belong to a psychiatric hospital.
Mm.
Do you understand what I'm saying? So elections are about many things. You know, part of it is the party, which mm-hmm. was also another important lesson that I have learned.
Mm-hmm.
Part of it is about the party. Part of it is about the structure, you know, across polling units across the country. Part of it is the financial capability to have polling agents across mm-hmm. the whole country to protect your votes. These are some of the lessons one has learned. On top of all that was new that I brought in, like policy-based politics, I was defining the issues. People mm-hmm. would listen to my interviews and walk away educated.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very important in our politics because it's for the people. So we should educate the people about what will be good for them and why each and every one of us as a candidate will bring that thing. But the politics of just vote for me because we're from the same village, vote for me because we're from the same ethnic group, vote for me because I have money to give you because you're poor, vote for me because we're from the same religion, it will not take Nigeria anywhere. Yeah.
Okay. So what you've learned is popularity is not enough. You need a party structure and you need financial capability.
Absolutely. Those are important lessons. Yes. Practical lessons in politics. Yes.
What does that mean for what you could have or might have done differently if you were going to look back? On this 2023 election cycle.
I had made arrangements for very significant financial support. Far more than I ever had in 2019. And there were people who were willing to put forward that financial backing had I emerged as a candidate.
So I'll just push you one more time on this.
Sure.
So when you said what happened was a game and a conspiracy.
Yes.
Now, in order for you to do anything else.
Yes.
that you've mentioned,
yes,
in terms of, you know, what you would do as a president, in terms, yes, of delivering internal change, changing the narrative, you have to win
the ticket,
a nominee ticket,
of
in
course,
the first
absolutely.
Place,
of
right?
Course, of course, yeah.
So,
I wanted to.
Is there a, and you did,
yeah, sure.
And we know. Let's just be,
yeah,
realistic.
Yeah.
We know how that works in,
of
Nigeria.
Course, absolutely.
It's,
yeah,
not a clean process.
No, not at all.
Winning,
yeah,
a party ticket is not a clean process.
Yes.
It's dirty.
Yeah.
And if you, some people would argue that if you want to play in Nigerian,
yeah,
politics, if you want to change Nigeria, you have to play the dirty politics first.
Not necessarily. You don't,
so,
have to, you don't have to become a pig to be able to win a party primary in Nigeria. But you see,
is there another way to do it?
Yes, there's another way to do it. Especially if you're a candidate of one of the smaller parties. That's why I said it was a conspiracy and a heist.
But,
because,
yeah,
because,
mm-hmm,
80% of the party members knew that with me as a candidate, the party would have a strong footprint in the 2023 elections and,
yeah,
be competitive. So that is currency also. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah,
that in itself is a currency. Yes. You know, so who will make us relevant? Who has the name recognition? Who has the appeal? Who has the competence in terms of track record? This candidate had it more than any other. In the discussions and the internal, I wouldn't call it debates, but presentations, everybody came out with the same conclusion. So for people to have that knowledge and that enthusiasm, and yet at the last minute, 72 to 48 hours to the primary, something went under the table. I laid it at the footstep of the leadership of the party.
At that point,
yes,
yeah.
And I said that their lack of ethical principles, because we had an agreement to prevent the financialization of the primaries.
Yeah.
But the party leadership did not keep the agreement. And so, that's what led to what happened. And they know why they didn't keep to the agreement. So let's not dwell on that. Let's move on.
Okay.
Yeah.
But do
there,
you think, my last
also,
question on
there
this.
There were also, I want to,
yeah,
mention something.
Mm-hmm.
There are also speculations. I cannot prove them.
Mm-hmm.
That there were powerful people in the political system who did not want me to emerge,
okay,
as a candidate. A,
yeah,
formal candidate of the party, because from the experience of 2019, they knew that my candidacy was bound to make a lot of waves. And given the feeling of younger people to determine the future of Nigeria, I could have rallied far more support than in 2019. So those interests,
right,
their interest was served by making sure that I did not emerge.
So let me ask,
yeah,
you a slightly different,
sure,
question, which is, do you think that the means ever justify the end?
Sometimes it does. Sometimes it does. But not all times.
Would it sometimes be reasonable or fair for a politician, especially like in the Nigerian, given our realities, to say,
yeah,
you know, I know this is how it works.
Yeah.
I don't want to be a part of it.
Yeah.
But you know what? You know,
see,
my people, go and sort it out.
Yes.
I don't want to know about it.
Exactly.
Sort it out. Make sure I win.
Sure. Politics
and
is not,
let
poli-
it just
politics is not
just
for,
don't involve me.
Politics is not for angels and saints.
Okay.
It's not about
so
sainthood and angelic natures. That's not what politics is anywhere in the world. So I'm not naive. You see what I'm saying? And I would not advise anybody to be naive about how political processes work out, especially,
okay,
in a third world or developing country like Nigeria.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
that's not to support,
fair,
you know,
yes,
the outright dollarization of party primaries, because our democracy is so weak because the internal democracy of political parties in Nigeria is so warped by money that they are not able to produce compelling candidates.
Yeah.
And that's why our democracy has not, we have not benefited from the dividends of democracy up to today.
So another question that often comes up,
yeah,
is why not seek a different elective office?
Okay.
Because a lot of people in politics,
yeah,
not just in Nigeria,
mm-hmm,
work their way up through the political,
mm-hmm,
pyramid, whatever you want,
yeah,
to call it, right?
Yeah.
Like you,
sure,
run for governor, you run for senate, you run for, Obama was a senator first.
Mm-hmm.
How did
and,
you think
and
through
what
this?
Was, and
why?
What, and what was Trump?
Well, he had a public persona already.
Yeah. Okay. So,
but yeah, so
maybe,
so,
like,
but
yeah,
how did you think through this for you? Like,
yeah,
why not seek,
yes,
a different elective office?
That's a very
good and
question.
Kind of cut your teeth in Nigerian politics that way.
Good. The truth about Nigeria is that Nigeria will not make progress unless and until it does either of two things. Either it restructures the country with a very significant devolution of powers down to states and regions, whichever structure you want to adopt, or it elects a transformational president. Do you understand? The National Assembly will not change Nigeria. I'm sorry. So I didn't see it as the best use of my time to be running for a seat in the National Assembly. I did not see it as the best move for me to run for governor of my state for various reasons. For one, the level of my leadership experience relative to what the job of a president entails, for me, outmatched any other candidate in the political system. The president of Nigeria has four functions: national security, nation building, managing the national economy, and foreign affairs. In all these four areas, all my life experience in international security and peacekeeping operations and cross-border counter-terrorism in the United Nations, nation building as a United Nations diplomat in Cambodia, in Rwanda, in Croatia, helping countries that have faced the kinds of pressures Nigeria is facing, ethnic conflicts, community conflicts, and low-level armed conflict, come out and become successful nations. Managing the Nigerian economy as a deputy governor of the central bank, I played a very, very key role in Nigeria's economy. That affected 200 million people, whether it's through the payment system, whether it's through bringing inflation down from 13% to 8% before we left office as a member of the Monetary Policy Committee, whether it's supervising a $200 billion banking system, you know, with 24 commercial banks, with 57 subsidiaries in 31 countries, in Africa, in North America, in Europe. So my responsibilities as a deputy governor of the central bank were vast and hugely consequential, and I executed them with impact. So that's preparation, not to talk about the intellectual preparation, because part of the problem with managing the Nigerian economy is that there is no philosophical foundation. And that's a product of intellectual equipment and knowledge. There are knowledge gaps. So all these people who have been governors and senators and all of that, yeah, the people may know or feel that they are the ones who are sort of politically prepared to run for president. But that has not delivered good governance so far. So the reason they think this way is because the people are not educated. That's the problem. So we have to educate the people. Then shall we talk about foreign affairs and my experience in foreign affairs as a United Nations diplomat for many years? So those were the reasons I chose to run for president, not for governor. Because none of these functions is the function of a governor.
So you thought your experience was better suited to the role of president, rather than anything else.
That's the reason I made that decision. So, plus also, there's just a question of your own personal interest, your own personal passion. For me, it was about the president, not about being governor. So governor is of course important, no question about it, but it's a question of what is of interest to you.
Yeah.
I mean, I was approached to run for governor of Anambra State even when I was deputy governor of the central bank, but I always knew it was not my interest. So there are also practical things. For example, the current governor of Anambra State is from my zone. Assume that he's in office for 8 years, it goes to another zone. So there's little or no prospect that I can, even if I was interested, that politically I can actually do it.
Yeah. So with all the experience you listed, right, I think the one thing you don't have is the political experience.
Well, as a presidential candidate, I have political experience.
Yeah, that's fair. But I mean actually being in
actually
politics,
being elected,
right? So the list to my next question, which I think is relevant even for some of the people running today.
Absolutely, yeah.
Which is, even if you had won the presidency,
yes.
to run the country,
yes.
you need to have a majority in Congress. You need to work with the senators.
That's what
you need to work with the governors.
Yes.
Right? And you need to understand how those processes work and be able to deal and
absolutely.
Wheel and do whatever it is that Nigerian politicians
do,
right?
I would have done that.
But how
would have defected to my party if I had won?
Maybe not.
Or maybe
so let's assume that they didn't.
Yeah.
Because PDP and APC are very well-entrenched parties in Nigerian politics.
Definitely.
You know, we were talking earlier.
But they are today being challenged by an outside force.
Yes, but they are very well-entrenched to the point where in parts of the country where there are no roads, no electricity, no water, you'll find PDP and APC, right? So
and that plays
it's not a necessarily a given that they would have left those party structures. You know, maybe. But maybe they could have stayed in those party structures. They could have impeached the president. They could have refused to work with the president. So how would you... Do you think that it's possible for a president...
I am a master at manufacturing consent and consensus. It comes from my diplomatic background in the UN. I have been able to get people who are at opposite ends of a room to come together. So it is the lack of skill that can, you know, if you have the right approach using a win-win scenario, when you show those parties what's in it for them, Nigerian politicians and politicians everywhere are selfish. So you create and sell the win-win scenario for all of us, then they may buy in.
So that's okay. That's the answer. So you think, because I was going to ask, do you think that a president, you know, if somebody like Peter Obi, for example, wins and doesn't have a majority, can he govern? Could he govern?
It is possible, of course.
He would have to be able to manufacture consent.
He would have to manufacture consent. He has to manufacture consensus. And that is possible. If you have the ability to do it. Because in whose interest is it if the country grinds to a halt? Because we are all not members of PDP and APC.
Well, you could say it's in their interest. If they impeach you and throw you out, then they can get one of their people to be president, right? Like it would be in their interest. I mean, it's politics.
Well, it's politics, but there are ways of getting around that. Right now, it's not my in my horizon.
Are you going to endorse or campaign for any of the current candidates?
Well, obviously as a Nigerian, I would like to vote for a candidate of my choice. But there are reasons why it may be difficult for me to endorse or campaign for any of the candidates. Here's why. First, there's a certain unique role that I play in this country. And you need to understand that. Many people look up to me for guidance, for ideas, for comments on public policy, and to be a unifying force. Even as a partisan politician in the past, I still had a unifying vision for the country. My vision was not ethnic, it wasn't religious and so on. So you are even much more able to play that role outside of a party platform than inside a party platform. So I want to maximize that potential to contribute to Nigeria as a non-partisan, say statesman, not elder, I'm not old yet, but at least as a statesman. You see what I'm saying? So that's one. The second is that I run a think tank, the Institute for Governance and Economic Transformation, which is my current platform for contribution of ideas about how we can transform public policy. We are working on a report on the Nigerian poverty trap and how to end it. Now, when you are on this sort of pedestal, the influence of your work is best protected if you're not partisan.
And not seen to be.
And not seen to be partisan. Yes, that's what I'm saying.
So that's the role you want to play.
That's the role I want
to
play in this cycle.
And that's why you don't want to
come
out in favor of any particular person.
But I can assess each of the candidates. And each one, if they do something good or they have a good policy position, I can,
can
I can say this is a good one.
Yes.
That's whether it's Peter Obi or Atiku or Tinubu, and you know, or I can say this is not good. You know, for example, much respect as I have for Atiku, but I recently had to criticize his statement before the Northern elders about what they need is a Northerner, not an Igbo or Yoruba candidate. I had to call that out. You know, it's not personal. I have a lot of respect for him, and I believe he's very experienced to be president. And talking about whether you should be governor or this or that, you know, it's like asking somebody who has been vice president of Nigeria whether you're qualified to be president because you have not actually been the CEO. Do you understand? Of course the person is qualified to be president, has the relevant experience. So anyway, but that's the point I was trying to make.
Let's talk about electoral reform. Because one of the things you did after the 2019 election was help advocate for electoral reforms along with civil society. And so I think, you know, now, we, as you know, we have the Electoral Amendment Act of 2022. It's been, I would say, widely recognized by everybody on both sides as a major
development,
development that will make it very difficult to manipulate the outcome of the vote. And for people who are not aware, you know, it mandates the use of a certain kind of technology called BVAS to accredit votes, which means that if you cannot match your biometric information, you cannot vote.
Yes.
There's no paper forms to get people who are not coming up in the system, who are not registered and who cannot match their biometrics to be able to vote, right? So automatically, it's going to reduce the vote totals because now you can only have the number of people who have been accredited, to vote.
Yeah.
And then the other thing it does is that it forces or it's...
electronic transmission.
So basically what that means, so sometimes, again, that can be confused. What that means is that there's going to be a picture, a PDF of results sheets from each polling unit taken and transmitted onto a public website where everybody can see. Right? I just wanted to say that
after
all the party agents, exactly.
Yes.
So those two things are, you know, could make this the most transparent process, right?
Yes.
How do you think that impacts, well, first, do you agree? And how do you think that could impact the outcome of the election?
Well, first of all, I'm very proud of the success of the effort, the joint effort of many well-meaning Nigerians, including my humble self. Like you were kind enough to note that I played a strong role in galvanizing support for that. I wrote to the president of the Senate and he responded to me personally. You know, and so on, advocating for that act to be passed. It is a watershed in the electoral system management of Nigeria, no question about it. So I hope, that is what I can say for now, I hope that it will vastly reduce the scope for rigging in the 2023 elections. But the taste of the pudding is in the eating. And so I cannot overpraise it until I have actually seen it work and deliver the results that we hope and expect it will deliver. So because, and I say this because I know that Nigerian politicians have a remarkable talent for negative innovation. And you cannot say with any certainty.
There's going to be a lot of vested interests in arguing that this election was rigged, regardless of the outcome, right? There are going to be people who will want to impugn the process and to cast doubts on the credibility of the process for their own selfish aims, even if there is a fair argument, and I'm not saying that this will be the case, but even if there's a fair argument that despite inevitable challenges in different places that the outcome maybe overall represents the interests of the people, we'll still have people who are going to argue that it was rigged. Now, how, I guess my question then is, knowing that reality, how should we approach, where do we draw the line, if there are challenges in some places, and there's some places that people are not able to vote, and maybe there's some security challenges, or maybe there's some human error here, how would you, as an observer and as a Nigerian, determine when to say, actually, this was a fair process? It wasn't perfect, but it was fair. Is there kind of like a threshold? Like, how do you think about it?
Yes. Well, first of all, I think, the question of people having a vested interest in undermining the integrity or the credibility of the elections, it's always there. So as we go into 2023, yes, the BVAS, the electronic transmission of results all increase the chance or the possibility or even, shall we say, the hope for a credible electoral outcome more than in past elections. Yes, I will admit that. But that can only be the case when it has actually happened. Mm-hmm. We have seen it.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot award INEC 100% pass mark based on, the expression of the Electoral Act, the new Electoral Act. It doesn't guarantee that nothing will go wrong. Do you see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't guarantee that at all. Because, like I said, you can never underestimate the talent of Nigerian politicians for negative innovation.
So this system may look almost foolproof to you, but the imaginativeness of Nigerian politicians is really legendary. There is a possibility, for example, that the election can be tampered with outside of the functioning of these two systems. Let's just take, for example, voter suppression through the registration process or even on voting day. If certain electoral constituencies preponderantly lived in those areas, there are ways of manipulating an election.
Voter suppression.
Exactly. Yeah. Voter suppression is outside of VBAS or electronic transmission. It can happen.
Yeah.
So that's why it is only when the election has happened that we can see how credibly it was conducted.
So then my question is, how will you know it has actually happened? How will you determine whether it is?
The point
because
is,
we don't,
let me tell you what
do you, we don't expect there to be anything. No voter. No.
Exactly.
What I mean is, I can comfortably today say that there will be voter suppression.
Okay.
That's how I feel.
Okay.
Right? It's Nigeria.
Okay.
There's going to be voter suppression. And probably on all sides. There will be different kinds of people who are trying, right? And maybe sanctioned by higher ups in the party, maybe not.
Yeah.
Right. But there's going to be some level of voter suppression.
Yeah.
There's going to be some level of vote buying.
Mm-hmm.
Now, my question is, at what point do we say...
If it is so widespread...
That it is credible, regardless of these imperfections.
Yes. Now, if the preponderance of the impact on the overall outcome of the election, if it happened in one local government area out of 774, would you then cancel the election because of that? Of course not. But if it is systemic,
widespread
across large areas, you cannot buy anybody's argument that the election was credible. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So this is it. I mean, it's about scale and impact. And it's also about people who allege being able to present facts that give credibility to their allegations.
Okay.
That's how you judge these things. You know, I think.
And my last question for you about 2023.
Yeah.
Are you worried about violence?
I am.
Whether it's before, during, or after.
I am absolutely worried because we have already begun to see it. There were attacks on the PDP party officials in Kaduna, and we saw it. There have been attacks against Labour Party people, and I also even read that there were attacks on a couple of APC people some places in the East. So you know, voter electoral violence is something we must make sure that is reduced to the barest minimum in 2023 because tensions are high. There's a lot of desperation on all sides. In 2023, there is no incumbent on the ballot of the presidential election. And therefore, the potential of things to get out of hand is very high. And this is why INEC, one of my
complaints... You think because there's no incumbent, the potential for things to get out of high is high because there's no incumbent?
Absolutely. Yes, let me explain that.
Yeah.
Because you have a number of very powerful politicians, almost equally matched.
Mm.
But none of them has the advantage of being the incumbent.
Mm.
One may be from an incumbent,
but
that's not the same thing as a president running for re-election.
Mm-hmm.
So the desperation is very high because all the parties see it that they have a chance to win because it's a more level playing field in a way, theoretically at least. Mm-hmm. So that's what I meant.
Okay.
Now, one of my lessons from the political process in Nigeria is that Nigerian politics is one of the least regulated anywhere in the world.
Mm.
And that's bad. Mm. INEC has a lot more work to do to regulate our politics, starting from the internal democracy of political parties down to the organization of the elections. Election organization is a project management exercise, but that's not how we take it in Nigeria. We appoint professors all over the place. You know, that's not the same thing as a logistical organization that functions well. And so I would have recommended the use of private or some other type of logistics or professional project management needs to come into Nigerian elections. But we don't see it. So INEC tries and does all these efforts, and the elections come and there are a lot of failures. It's very disappointing, you know? And we should have hoped that by now, look at Brazil. They will have elections on the 30th, runoff elections.
Yeah.
And I'm seeing the electoral court, a judicial construct, already very active in sanctioning candidates and parties from using fake news and propaganda. It's a very intrusive way of elections management, and it's still difficult. But we don't even see that level of intrusiveness in
Nigeria. So you have that level of... Maybe it's a process. Maybe because if we did that now, then there'll be arguments that, you know, the government is favoring one side over the other. So maybe, you know, less intrusion is actually better now, because it, there would be state agencies that are doing
this. I think INEC should be far more inclusive and far more hands-on with the way they manage elections in this country. There's a lot of room for improvement, because people will always want to cheat.
Right. What role do you think politicians and leaders have to play in the rhetoric that you use after the election to prevent that sort of rhetoric or violence stoking rhetoric?
Yes.
To basically, you know, play up ethnic sentiment in the aftermath of the election to say we lost because XYZ was rigged against us as a people.
This is one of the reasons why I have chosen to be nonpartisan in this particular election cycle, so that one can have a pedestal from which one can comment, one can influence, along a path of unity and stability and peace, regardless of who wins or who loses. You know, if the facts do not support any negative interpretation, we will discourage those kinds of interpretations simply because a candidate lost. There will only be one winner in that election. Whether it goes in the first round or whether they have to go back to a second round is immaterial. One person will emerge as the winner. That's always the way it is.
And some people will lose and they'll be unhappy that they lost.
Exactly. So I don't see why in this particular case it has to begin to stoke secessionist sentiment or stoke... No, I don't think so.
And you would be one of those people who would speak up in favor of the credibility of the process if you believe it is credible.
If I believe
it. And we've talked about how you would believe it's credible. Yeah. Okay.
If I believe it's credible, why would I not use whatever influence I have to cajole people to become, even if they're lost?
And in your view, it would be credible if you see elections are able to go forward smoothly in a majority
vast majority, not just majority. If you give me a 55% or 60% smooth performance and 40%, it's obvious that things were just wrong. I cannot certify that sort of election management, you know. So the onus is on INEC, and they really have to show us as a country. People know that somebody will win and somebody will lose. So
people pretend not to know that sometimes.
People accept more easily that they have lost when there's no real evidence of rigging against them. They may allege it, but if they don't come up with any serious evidence, they know it's just sour grapes. Okay. You see what I'm saying?
Okay, that's fine.
And they will calm down eventually.
Nobody's
happy to lose an election.
Do you think the 2019 election was overall credible?
The 2019 election, I think the credibility of that election was fundamentally challenged, even by international electoral observers. They made that judgment that the credibility of that election was very weak. I know from personal experience, participating in that election, let me give you a personal example. My personal assistant at the time, a young man who comes from Yobe State, knows everything, you know, concerning my life. He was in Yobe, in Potisco, while they were counting the votes in 2019. And he called me. We did not come. This was one of the few states... Prof, he said, this was one of the few states we did not visit because I was concerned about security. I did not go to the states where a lot of Boko Haram activity was going on because I didn't have the financial muscle to have the kind of security I felt I needed. So we were not able to get there. He said, we didn't come here, but they've counted the votes. You have 3,000 votes. I'm here. I'm looking at it. Just people listening to you on television, radio, and all of that. I said, oh, that's interesting. I was watching the official announcements of the elections later that night, or was it the next day? Yobe State, presidential elections, YPP, 66 votes. There's a huge difference between 66 and 3,000. It's happened again. YPP, 200 votes. That's a fraction of the people who come to receive me at the airport when I land in Ghana. My supporters of my own party. So to tell me that 200 million people vote, 200 people voted for me in Ghana is laughable. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, so
these are the kind of things that,
On the notes, I think.
I chose not to litigate. To contest the results. Yes.
Okay, so on the notes that if, as we've discussed and defined it, the election is smooth in a vast majority of the polling units, you and others will help to support the outcome, right? And ensure that we don't have violent unrest in any parts of the country.
I think that would be a statesmanly role.
Yeah.
You know,
that has to be supported by the fact that
the election was free and fair.
So I think that's a great place to end.
Absolutely.
Let's pray for that outcome and hope that everything goes smoothly.
Of course.
Thank you again for coming on the show.
Thank you, Amaka, for having me.
Thank you for being a part of today's interesting program. You can learn more about the NESG's If Not Now When campaign at www.ifnotnowwhen.ng. You can also listen to other interesting conversations by visiting www.nesggroup.org/podcasts.